Morning. I want to welcome you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to this time of worship. If you're here for the first time, we extend a special welcome to you, and also hope that you will join us today for World Communion. So all are invited to the table. We have been working through this sermon series, Why We Gather. It is based on this book by Priya Parker, and Priya Parker actually was this morning on Being, the program on NPR with Krista Tippett. So you could listen to that conversation. You can get it on podcast or website or wherever. But the idea behind this is to be intentional about our gatherings. Intentional, whether it's two people or three people, any kind of gathering, we are supposed to be focusing on the art of gathering, why we gather, how we gather, and how we bring intentional space of welcome. And the pandemic, actually the conversation this morning was about how the pandemic impacted our gatherings. We had a gathering at our home yesterday, and it felt odd, to be honest with you, like to have people over. And I was thinking, wow, how odd. It felt like, you know, a new thing. And so, because we have had a period of time where we haven't had people over, or we haven't been gathering as much because of the pandemic. And so how do we come back and look at the things that have worked for us during the pandemic, and the things that we've innovated, like now we have live streaming every time we gather. That's gonna be a thing that we continue with, which is beautiful. Then if you're sick, if you're in California with family, you can get up at 6 o'clock and watch and join in. And it's just wherever we are gathered in new ways. And so today we are focusing on active welcome. The first week we talked about being intentional about purpose. Last week we talked about sacred spaces. And this week we're talking about how we can be intentional about welcome, about being active hosts. And so the best example I know of is Christ himself being our host, being the one who pursues us, who welcomes us. And I have a little video about welcome and hospitality.
Ever since I was a child growing up by the rice paddies of Indonesia, I've known what it feels like to be an outsider. Born into a missionary family, I learned early on what it's like being a stranger in a foreign land, and I identified with other outsiders that I met along the way. But in every place I lived, the table has always been a place of welcome. It's a place where people slow down, let down their guards, tell stories, and connect. When I'm seated at a table with steaming food and diverse people around me, I feel more alive than any other place. It wasn't until later in life that I realized this transforming effect of the table, this deep sense of home and belonging I felt, was an experience of hospitality and part of a bigger story, the Christian story. It was a story of God welcoming humanity into God's love and kingdom family, and then urging those welcome to pay it forward, to extend the welcome they receive to others. I learned that the culminating story in Scripture is of a great heavenly wedding feast, where God and God's people from every tribe and nation will gather around an exquisite banquet table. The more I studied, I also came to realize that Christian hospitality is much more than having friends over for dinner. Hospitality in Greek is philoxenia, literally love of the stranger. And that's what it meant in the ancient world, loving or taking responsibility for the well-being of a stranger. God instructed the Hebrew people to remember what it felt like to be foreigners in Egypt and to deal justly with strangers in their own land. The early Christians, living as a persecuted minority within the Roman Empire, strongly identified with outsiders and were well respected for how they cared for the vulnerable. And Jesus himself was very clear about loving the stranger in Matthew 25. He tells his disciples that when they serve the least of these, the hungry, the thirsty, the stranger, the naked, the sick, and the prisoner, they were in fact serving him in disguise. I began to wonder, what does it look like for an ordinary church to live this out? So I set out on a quest to find local churches and everyday Christians who are practicing radical hospitality and welcoming the strangers in their own communities, and doing it in a way that was sustainable for the long haul. Along the way, I discovered several churches all over North America living out this practice in ways that were beautiful and unique. I visited a Reformed church in the Midwest, where the congregation was primarily composed of prisoners and ex-offenders. I visited a mega church in the Deep South, where families adopt 2, 3, even 4 kids from their county's foster care system and international orphanages. I visited a parish church in a bustling city where very diverse people intentionally share neighborhood life together. I visited a mainline denominational church in an inner city that is serving and sharing life with its low-income neighbors and people of different races. And I visited a charismatic church in the Canadian Bible Belt where people with disabilities are a central pillar of the church. Even though these churches were unique in their size, denomination,
I decided to stop it there because it keeps going. But you get the idea of the invitation of Christ to us to practice the hospitality we experience here today. So today, as we think of World Communion Sunday and the experience of Christians around the world coming to the table, I invite us to think of how we are being welcomed by Christ and how we extend the same welcome to others and being active about it. So I'm going to invite us to center ourselves and take a moment to pray. And today we're going to use the welcome prayer. And I've introduced this before to you, and it is a prayer that you can use throughout the day. I will begin it with just an introduction prayer to this time. But the prayer is about welcoming the Holy Spirit to every situation, welcoming all of life, all of our feelings, but also welcoming the Holy Spirit to our experience. So center yourself and be present to this moment. Breathe deeply as we pray together. God, we give you thanks for welcoming us this day into your heart of love. Bless our gathering and bless our world, so that we may be instruments of your welcome to those who feel rejected or alone. God, we bring to you those places in our hearts, experiences that we reject in ourselves as well. We bring them to your hospitality, to your welcome, to your generous love. And now we open our hearts to you using the welcome prayer. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I welcome everything that comes to me today because I know it is for my healing. I welcome all thoughts, feelings, emotions, persons, situations, and conditions. I let go of my desire for power and control. I let go of my desire for affection, esteem, approval, and pleasure. I let go of my desire for survival and security. I let go of my desire to change any situation, condition, person, or myself. I open to your love and presence, O God. I open to your action, your divine action within me. For we pray this in the way of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our first song this morning is called Awake My Soul. So please stand as you are able and join in singing if you would like to. We've done this one before, but it's been a long time. to find any truth in your lies. And now my heart stumbles on things I don't know. This weakness I fear I must finally show. Lend me your hand and we'll conquer them all. Change what you see, but your soul you must keep totally free.
So thinking about why we gather, one of the things that Priya Parker in her book, The Art of Gathering, mentions is something I didn't even know about. It's called Dinner en Blanc. Ordine en Blanc, which is an event that happens all over the world, I guess in major cities, and basically it's dinner in white. It started in Paris, France, by a man, you'll watch the video and tells you the story, by the name of François Pasquier. He had a group of friends he invited to dinner, but then the space was not big enough, so they agreed to meet in a park. Well, he didn't tell them the location until the last minute, but the idea was to wear white so they could identify each other, they could see each other and identify each other. And so it was a fancy dinner in a park. And so this was in 1988, and this became a big event that took off, and every year now it happens in cities all over the world, where people gather, and we're talking about 15,000 people or so, and you get you have to get a special invitation in order to be part of this, and there are rules on what you can do and cannot do in order to make it a really meaningful event. I'm thinking the next wine walk, you could suggest to Batavia, the city of Batavia, they could do a Dîner en Blanc. But the idea behind it is to include people. And it's really interesting because at first I'm thinking, you know, it's got to be just white people. But it's not true. It's people from different cultures and backgrounds, people in different continents. And it's the idea that people gathering and doing something special together, we all have these connections to meals. If you think back on childhood and think about visiting relatives, and those special meals are just what stays with us. And so today we're speaking about a special meal, but before we get into that, I'll let you watch just a little bit so you can get a glimpse of what this Dîner en Blanc is about.
Thank you.
thoughts, reactions? Have you heard of this before? Of course, we live in a small town, but yes. Yeah, we're like the huge cities. That's right. It takes a lot of organization. They bring their own food, but they share, and you have the table, and so you decorate your own table. This is all decorated by people. They carry the stuff with them. Imagine that. So all this opulent stuff is just really by people like us bringing whatever and really celebrating and coming together and this experience, and people finding this to be so joyful and so meaningful, to just do something where everyone is included. And as I said, sometimes we think of etiquette at the table because we have, you know, we learn, okay, so I went recently to a restaurant, and after a long time of not going to a restaurant, I was looking like, oh, where do they put the table? Where do they put the forks? And I'm like, oh my gosh, I forgot. You forget these things after 2 or 3 years of not being able to get out. But this is supposed to be about rules and people experiencing the rules being set equally for everyone. So no one is, you don't have to have prior knowledge, you just have to follow the rules that are given for this event. And it made me, of course, this came to my mind when thinking of Jesus and his preparations for the feast that he was gonna have with his disciples. He was very intentional about how he set it up. Again, this is all about creating an atmosphere of intentional welcome. This is the theme for today, active welcome. So we tend to think, you know, just set the food and everything will be fine. But really, this is about being very intentional about how we set things up. And so today the story is from Luke 22. Jesus is going to have a Passover meal. Now, for those of us who are not Jewish, we miss a lot of the meaning of the feast because this was the tradition, and the story is about the liberation of the people of God from slavery in Egypt. And so this was a feast they celebrated every year. Now think about that. Kind of like, you know, Dîner en Blanc, thinking of new traditions, but this was an ancient tradition, reminding the people of the salvation that they experienced. Now I have a little video about Seder, but it's not exactly the same of what Jesus was experienced, but this is, if you have any Jewish friends, you know that they celebrate the Seder meal once a year to experience God's salvation once more. But the retelling of the story is through a meal. Now think about it, you could be told the story verbally or you could read it in the Bible, but it's a very different thing when you experience the story. And that's what we try to do when we come together to the table. So we'll watch this video about Seder.
Passover Seder, or in American, Seders, come in many forms, from those filled with skits, to those lasting all night, to those rushed through in an effort to get to the food. Whatever your Seder, there are some symbols and customs you'll see most of the time. In the middle of the table, there's wine, a stack of matzah, and a cup of wine for Elijah the prophet, who's said to visit every Seder. Additionally, there's the Seder plate. It can be anything from a fancy ceramic piece imported from Israel to a makeshift number hacked together from picnic ware. On the Seder plate, a shank bone, egg, bitter herb, charoset, karpas, and a piece of lettuce. Each thing symbolizes a different aspect of Passover. Also, everyone has a Haggadah, the book or printouts that guides you through the Seder. There are tons of different Haggadahs, minimal and elaborate. You can get them in Hebrew, English, or both, with any kind of commentary you like, from feminist to environmental to Hasidic to political. There are versions for kids, for interfaith groups, and for activists. And of course, people remix the tradition every which way to make it their own. Seder literally translates to order, so let's talk about that. There's a few traditions to start. Blessing the wine, washing your hands, dipping veggies into salt water, and then breaking the middle matzah. Half of it, called the afikoman, gets hidden surreptitiously. Then comes the main event, the telling of the Exodus from Egypt. Or more accurately, the main event is an interactive reading of rabbinical discussions about how to remember the Exodus. When the Seder was put together, the rabbis assumed everyone going in knew the story, so it was silly to just retell it. Instead, they went deeper, and in doing so, created a holiday that is about memory. How do people, today, relate to these themes of liberation and redemption? At many seders, people go around the table and read a paragraph each from the Agadah. People add songs and discussions about what happened back then and about parallels with today's world. Seders around the world may include diverse traditions, like hitting your neighbor with green onions, pouring water on the floor, or pulling out a bag of plushy plates. And overachievers hold all-night seders. One famous part of the seder is the four questions, where the youngest child at the table asks, Ma nishtana? If you are the youngest child, you can practice here. Learning songs is a great way to prep for the seder. If you have to pick one, make it the chorus to Dayenu. It's one word, and you can learn it here. After the storytelling piece, there's a few more customs. More hand washing, eating matzah, then maror, something bitter like horseradish, then a matzah maror sandwich, and then dinner. If you're at a Sephardi Seder, there might be kitniyot included. People's strenuousness about keeping kosher for Passover varies widely. For instance, some folks won't eat anything made with wet matzah, including the Passover staple, matzah balls. After the main meal and dessert, there's the search for the afikoman. Whoever finds it gets a prize, and everyone else gets the ability to finish the meal with a tiny piece of matzah. Now, just being honest, a lot of sedels peter out here with tired kids and matzah kugel-induced food comas. But at a full sedel, you continue with Birkat HaMazon, the grace after meals, followed by opening the door for Elijah, a special set of songs of praise called Halel, more wine, and the famous closeout next year in Jerusalem.
All right, so you get, this is the American version of it, and each culture has it differently depending on where the Jewish community is gathered. But you see how important it is to remember the story. So this was a very essential meal for Jesus, being a Jew, and his friends gathered. And so he set it up. He before getting into the upper room, we tend to just read that story. Jesus was gathered in the upper room with his friends. But before that, he was very intentional about where they were going to meet, how they were going to meet, who was going to set it up. And we'll read this story. But before we move on, any thoughts on the Seder and Passover meal and the retelling of the story that way? Okay, good. All right, so we are into Luke 22. Then came the day of the unleavened bread, on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. So Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and prepare the Passover for us, that we may eat it." So he's sending two of his disciples. They asked him, "What do you want us to make preparations for it?" "Listen," he said to them, "when you have entered the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him into the house he enters. And say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks you, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, already furnished. Make preparations for us there." So they went and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. So you see the details? You see that Jesus is very involved. Now, some interpretations go into Jesus knew about this somehow because he had some supernatural powers. But a better interpretation of this is to say that Jesus was very intentional. He made that trek before. He had established this relationship with a man with a jar of water, and that's kind of a big clue right there. I think it's because we tend to hear about who usually carrying water, jars of water. Most biblical stories don't involve men. Usually they involve women. Women usually had the task of carrying the water. So when you see somebody, a man carrying a jar of water, that was a sign. So that was, Jesus had to be discreet. He's going into Jerusalem. This was a high holiday, high holy day, and authorities were really on alert. They knew this was happening. They knew this was coming. And so they were thinking, we don't want trouble. And so Jesus was going in under disguise. And so he told them, go and find this man. When you see him, follow him. So again, they're not going to talk to him and make conversation and talk about this. This is all secret. So they're going in, they go into the house, and they ask this person, whom I believe that Jesus had already established a relationship with and checked out the venue with, to say, you know, where's the space? Where are we going to meet? And then he asks the two disciples to set it up. Of course, they must have had help, because as you can see, this was a feast. So it couldn't have been just the two of them. And I'm sure the owner of the house had a lot to do with it. So Jesus took a lot of effort. And it's funny, because this is part of the three Gospels. They tell us this part, that Jesus was very intentional. And then there are different details in it. But there is this whole intentional effort, sending the disciples ahead of time, not telling them where the location is, because again, who was in the company of the disciples? Judas. Judas was there, and he was working with the authorities, and he was going to hand them over. So Jesus was really very concerned about making sure that this feast happened. Why was it so important for Jesus? Because he wanted to establish something for his disciples that would last them a lifetime, and then would be passed on from generation to generation to become a cornerstone for the community of Christ. Think about the feast that took place, the Passover, and how it was passed on from generation to generation, where the Israelites experienced something that was tremendous of God's salvation, and then they pass it on to their children and their grandchildren, and then all the generations after. And so Jesus was doing exactly the same thing, using something old, but bringing a new community to it, and bringing the fulfillment of God's love into this feast. So one of the things that Priya Parker says is, don't be a chill host. And I think this really is a great metaphor for what Jesus didn't do. He wasn't a chill host. He didn't just say, well, we'll just see if we can just find a spot to gather. He didn't say, well, you know, why don't you just go scout it out and find us a place to go. Really was engaged in it, saw the importance of the gathering and how people would hang on to this feast. And imagine, how many years later, we're still doing the same thing. We're still remembering the same feast. We're still remembering the table of Christ. We still come together and pray and believe that his presence is with us. One of the things we believe is that this feast is a glimpse or a foretaste of God's eternal realm, where all things belong in perfect harmony. And this is a beautiful piece for me, because I always think of the table of Christ being so inclusive, so open to all of us, very intentionally. Even though human beings try to put limits on the table, well, if you're not baptized, you can't come, or if you don't belong to this religious group, you can't come, or if the bread is leavened, you can't, whatever limitations that we put on it. But God is the host, and all of us are welcome. This past week, if you've had great successes, raise your hand. Oh my goodness, all right? You know, like if you've lived your life well this past week, okay, if you, yes, yeah. If you failed this last week, raise your hand, all right? If you were kind a lot, raise your hand, all right? If you were, you know, short sometimes, raise your hand. Okay. And guess what? All of us are invited. It doesn't matter if we raised our hands at being really successful or great or wonderful, or life was just great for us, or if life was really difficult, or we were part of the problem. We're invited the same. And you know, when you experience welcome in that way, when you feel that sense of welcome, it changes things for you. Have you ever gone to a meal where you got invited and you felt obligated to go? Raise your hand. All right. Because, you know, so-and-so said, you know, you must go. And we all do these things. But then you go, and then you come back, and you're so energized. And you're like, wow, I'm so glad I went. I have this conversation often with my mom. She is one of those people now, she wants to stay home all the time. And it's so hard to get her out of the house. But then when she goes, and she always comes back, and I always want to just record those conversations and play them back to her. I had such a great time. It was so much fun. I got to enjoy the kids and da-da-da. And then it's like, Mom, you need to remember that the next time you get an invitation. It's important. It makes us feel so connected to others. Yes, we can stay at home and do our own thing, but when we gather, when we bring this welcome to each other, something shifts in us. When somebody brings you the food and makes the food for you, you feel cared for. There's such grace in that experience, in that human experience, and it changes us. It changes us to see that the same welcome can be extended to those we deem unlovable, unworthy. And it is that transformation that God is working through us. It's kind of like a pay it forward, a concept. You receive, you are gifted. You don't have to do anything to earn God's grace. But then once you experience that, you pass it to others. You pay it forward. If you've gone to, you know, Dunkin' Donuts or Tim Hortons and somebody pays for you, have you ever had that experience? The people in front of you, yes, they pay for you. And then what do when that happens? You pay for the people that are behind you too. You know, you feel, and nobody is obligating you to do that, but there is such joy that somebody cared to do that for you. And people do it all over the world, all the time. And so I want to end with watching a little video before we get into this this meal we're together. And this video is from a movie called Places in the Heart. It's an older movie, and so the quality is not that great of the images, but this is a communion scene. This is the ending of the movie. Any of you have seen the movie? Few of you. It's a great movie. It's a story of hardship. It's about a widow. The movie starts with a scene of her husband being killed at the sheriff by a black kid who was drunk. He was playing with a pistol. And it goes off, and he kills the sheriff. And you can imagine, this is in the South, and you can imagine this was in the Great Depression. So again, the racism and all the fear among the people was still very much alive. And so the KKK, they come and they torture and they kill this kid. And it sets off the whole scene, the whole movie on a journey of suffering. And this widow, Sally Fields, plays the role of the widow. And she struggles to make a go of the farm that was left for her without her husband's income, without his effort. And she takes in a couple of boarders who end up helping her. One was a black man, one was a veteran, a blind man. And they struggle, but the KKK was still active, and the hate in the movie was just so powerful. But then at the end, they're in the church, and nothing is really unusual about the scene. You're sitting there, you're watching, you know, they're singing, they're reading scriptures, they're doing just like what we do. But then the communion trays are passed. This isn't a tradition where they pass the communion elements and trays to each other. And at first, you're just seeing the regular congregation, just like we are, but then you see the greater reality, the reality of God's vision, the kingdom of God, where you see all these different people, the people who are estranged from each other, sitting with each other, the people who were, the young boy who was killed by the KKK, he's in the communion experience, the black man who got run out of town, all of these people, black, white, estranged, loved, welcomed, unwelcome, rejected, hated. Everyone is sitting together, and I think it's just so brilliant how they did this. Michael, you probably have seen this movie. You have any commentary before they watch this the scene?
No. I don't really have any commentary, but I've seen this. You may want some tissue.
Okay. Again, to know that it's just, it takes you from the real to the greater real in the realm of God.
This morning we take our text from 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter, verses 1 through 8. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not love, I am become as a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and all knowledge, and have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor and have not love, it profiteth me nothing. Love is patient, kind. Love is not jealous or boastful. Love never ends.
Reminder that there are places in the heart for each of us. In the heart of God, in our own hearts, there is a place for that divine welcome, for that active welcome, for us to experience the presence of God. So today, as we come to the table, I'm going to invite us to take a few moments as our call to the table, but the few moments of silence, I'm going to invite you to allow the Holy Spirit to call a person to mind, or persons to your mind, whether they're in this life or in eternal life, maybe someone you're estranged from, someone you are missing greatly, it doesn't matter. Let the Holy Spirit bring that person to your attention, and allow the Holy Spirit to also let you see that they are part of this communion. They are part of this table. And so let's take a few moments to gather ourselves and allow Christ to bring all of this to this table of grace. God, we thank you for being such an active host, welcoming all of us, welcoming us to this feast of love, reminding us of the eternal connections that we have at this feast. We pray that we may experience your welcome in a new and fresh way. May your spirit fall on us, on these elements, to remind us of your very presence. Help us to be part of this body in this moment, but also in the larger context of eternity. We thank you that people around the world are celebrating this feast today, experiencing the joy of coming together, of gathering, to allow you to be our host, to show us the way of grace, so that we may extend the same grace to others. We pray this in the way of Jesus Christ. Amen. So friends, we come to this table remembering that on the night of his arrest, our Lord Jesus Christ took the bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, and after giving thanks to God, he blessed it, and he gave it to his disciples, reminding them that this is a sign of the new covenant that was sealed in his blood, shed for the forgiveness of sins, and reminding them that whenever they did this, they drank from the cup to remember him and to share that memory with others, to bless others. And so friends, I invite you, whether you're at home with your elements or here, to take the piece of bread and the cup and to partake, and remembering this is the body of Christ and this is the blood of Christ. And this is the feast where all are welcome and included. Body of Christ and the cup of Christ's love for us. And we give thanks for our generous host, his love and his connection to us, and the people who have celebrated this in this congregation throughout the world, and our connection to the greater body of Christ. Amen.
Our last song this morning is called "Next to Me," so please stand as you are able and join as you wish. Thank you. chance on me. I know it isn't easy, but I hope to be worth it. So thank you for taking a chance on me. I know it isn't easy, but I hope to be worth it. Oh, I always let you down. Shattered on the ground, still I find you there next to me. And oh,
for the blessing. Never forget that you are always welcome in the heart of God and that you are never alone. May this grace free you to live each day with the blessing of a generous God, to celebrate the gift of each moment and each person you encounter. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore.